بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمد عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن خير الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدى هدى رسول الله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Today's Darus, inshallah, this reminder, is more of a fiqh about bid'ah than it is anything else. It's not an opportunity that we're going to take to bash Muslims who fall into bid'ah, because the reality of the matter is the vast majority of people have fallen into bid'ah. The issue of innovation, it has crept into every single nook and cranny of the Muslim identity. It is something you can find amongst the awam, the ammat al-nas, just the regular people, regular Muslims. And it's also something that you find amongst the khawas, the special people, ulama, students of knowledge, people of the sunnah. Every aspect of every issue in al-Islam, you'll find bid'ah, innovation, it has connected itself to many Muslims to the point that many people don't even know that some of the things that they are doing are innovations. People who should know better, people who claim that they know better, are falling into innovations. When we look at the ibadat, when we look at the mu'amalat, when we look at the aqa'id, the aqidah, you'll find innovation has crept into the Islamic identity of many people. Most important issue in al-Islam is what we believe in and how we believe. The aqidah of the Muslim. Every issue of aqidah, there's innovation that a large number of people have fallen prey to. Most of you know that there is the issue of the aqsam of a tawheed. Different categories of a tawheed. The tawheed of the names and the attributes of Allah. The tawheed of the lordship of Allah. The tawheed of the uluhiyya of Allah. The fact that he deserves to be worshipped alone. In each and every one of these divisions of tawheed, there is innovation in what people take as their religion. Not only that, some Muslims who are politically oriented, they are inclined, and their main motivation is politics and the dirty nature of politics, the politics of Machiavelli, and other than that, they have come and they added on to the three aqsam of a tawheed, and they added their own division called Tawheed al-Hakimiyya, an innovation in and of itself. And we're waiting to see, inshallah, Tawheed al-Jihadiyya and Tawheed al-Takfiriyya. Even there's going to be a Tawheed about taking care of the guest. Innovations in every aspect of the identity of the Muslim. Not in the deen, but in the way the Muslims exist. The Salat, Hadith Wala Haraj, innovations left, right, and center in the way that we pray to Allah Azza wa Jalla on a daily basis, the way we read the Quran, the Zakat, innovations, fasting, innovations. We just came back from an Hajj. And when you go to Hajj, there are many lessons to be learned from the Hajj. And one of the main lessons is the condition of the Muslim Ummah. And at the Hajj, you see the innovation of this Ummah. There are those people who, they want to throw the stones at a shaitan, at the Jamarat. So they pick up the stones wherever they get them from, Muzdalifa, Arafat, Mina, and they put them in a cup and they soak it with Zamzam overnight because they really want to get that shaitan. There are those other people who, when they put their ihram on, they put the ihram on. They want to go to the Prophet's grave to put the ihram at the grave of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam because he has love for the Nabi and he feels and going to the Nabi's grave sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going to give him added strength and added taqwa and added proof about his ikhlas to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is a Nissan Micra, the license plate VK51CEL. Your car is blocking some of the people. We have the innovation of the Hajj and the innovation of the Eid of those Muslims who want to slaughter for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He does the udhiyah for himself and he gives also a sacrifice for the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There are those people who, if they don't go to the grave of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they will feel that their Hajj is incomplete. Although, if you never went to Medina during your Hajj, you never went. It has nothing to do with your Hajj. It's not from the ahkam of the Hajj at all. And if you do choose to go to Al-Medina, your goal and your objective, your niyyah should be to go to the masjid to worship Allah. And while you're there, you're going to visit the grave of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. People make their niyyah the grave. And the people go to Mount Uhud. And at the Mount Uhud, they go to the 70 to 80 shuhada of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam from his companions. And they insist that they have to stay there. And they have to go in the maqbara across the street from his masjid. And they have to throw rice at the birds. Innovation, left, right, and center in all aspects of the deen. Even as I mentioned, every place that you go, every place, and no place escapes it. Almost all of the masajid, and I'm not here to bash people and to put people down. I'm telling you about something that has manifested itself. Our masjid, almost all masjids, people of the sunnah are falling into innovation. No place has escaped it. The best masjids in al-Islam, the Masjid al-Haram in Mecca, the Prophet's masjid, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Bayt al-Maqdis, innovation in all of them. Al-Imam Malik, the great scholar of al-Islam, he said, anywhere where you find a masjid where the people can hear the Imam saying Allahu Akbar and moving from place to place from different positions, then for someone to holler out after him, Allahu Akbar, and to repeat after him so that the people can hear is an innovation. Because that only happened when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam became sick and it was difficult for him to pray and it was difficult for him to raise his voice. So he would say Allahu Akbar with a soft voice and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu would make the takbir so that the people behind the Nabi could hear. But now in Mecca and Medina, if a person came and wrote a book, the innovations in the two masjids, it would be a beneficial book. Innovation has crept into every nook and cranny of the Muslim identity. Even with Salafi people, a Salafi is the haq, no doubt about that. A Salafi meaning understanding the Quran and the Sunnah the way the companions understood it. That's the deen. That was the deen back then, and that's the deen today. People who are upon Salafiyya fall into innovations. The innovation of forcing people to take your position when it is an issue of ijtihad, an issue of ikhtilaf. This scholar who you like takes a position, and another scholar takes a different position. And you as the student are allowed to choose based upon your understanding. You choose that scholar, and you go against what I'm saying. I don't agree with what he's saying, or I don't agree with that point. And I come and I make you an innovator because you disagree with me. Or I say that you can't force people to take his position. We have that in Birmingham, and we have other than that. This is one of the big sicknesses of Salafi people today. If you don't take what Sheikh Rabi said, then people will take a position against you. If you have the nerve and the audacity to say, I don't blindly follow that man or this man or that man. The only person who I see as being ma'soom is the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. People will criticize you. Innovation with the people of the Sunnah in many shapes, forms, and fashions. Testing people about statements and positions and other people. Innovation, people of the Sunnah. So the point here is, today's talk is not an attempt to bash Brelwis and Deobandis and Sufis and Ikhwanis and Tablighis. Today's talk is about innovation has crept into the homes of many people, and some of them don't even know it, as people are trying to be upon the Sunnah. So for this reason, the ulama of Islam, they took the time out, past and present, to deal with this issue. And they wrote books all about innovations. The book is only about innovations. How to deal with the innovators. The way you deal with an innovator, you can deal with him in an innovative way, a way that is an innovation. Passing judgments and the way you make tabdir of people, you yourself can be making innovation. And those other scholars, they wrote books, and all of the books of hadith, all of them, Sahih Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, Abu Dawud, At-Tirmidhi, An-Nasa'i ibn Majah, all of them have a chapter telling the people about the importance of al-i'tisam, holding on to the sunnah. And in that is a chapter or ayat, a hadith, warning against innovation. So the point here is, this is a serious issue. It is a major sin. And for that reason, Al-Imam Al-Dhahibi rahimahullah ta'ala has put it in his book, Kitab Al-Kaba'ir. And you'll see why it's a major sin. And we studied that book, Kitab Al-Kaba'ir. How do we know that something is an innovation? We know that it is an innovation because the Prophet said it was an innovation. Allah or his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said this thing is a major sin. We know that it's a major sin because of the description that has been attached to it. Whoever does this, Allah won't look at him, yawm al-qiyamah. Whoever does that, he'll be with the shaytan, yawm al-qiyamah. The Prophet will free himself from that individual, yawm al-qiyamah. And we know that a thing is a major sin if a had is attached to it. So the innovation is no doubt from the major sins. Linguistically, al-bid'ah, linguistically. What is the bid'ah, linguistically? The bid'ah is that thing that has been introduced for the first time and it didn't have the likes of it before. It's the first time that it was presented. In the dunya, it's an innovative issue. The camera, there was a time that it didn't exist. Someone came up with the idea when it was invented and introduced. That is a bid'ah in the dunya, no problem. This microphone didn't exist at one time. Someone came up with the brilliance of putting it together and here it is. This is a bid'ah. That's what bid'ah is in the language, and there's nothing wrong with that. Allah Ta'ala has made reference to this type of innovation in a number of ayat in the Quran. He said about himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala, badi'u samawati wal ard. Idha arada amrin, idha qada amrin, fa'innama yaqulu lahu, kun fayakun. Allah is the badi' of the heavens and the earth. He is the originator of the heavens and the earth. There was a time, there was no heaven and there was no earth. Allah Azzawajal innovated them. He created them before they didn't exist. At a time, they didn't exist. So from his name is, from his names, his Asma al-Husna al-Badi' Abdul Badi'. Allah Ta'ala also told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Qul ma kuntu bid'an min ar-rusul." Tell the people of Quraysh, "I'm not a bid'ah. I'm not the first messenger that ever came. I'm not the first one. There were those who came before me." That's the linguistic meaning. Tell them, "I'm not the first one to come. I'm not a bid'ah. There are other prophets and messengers who came before me." In terms of ibadat, but it's dealing with something that is new, Allah Azza wa Jalla has described al-kitab. Al-kitab, who looked at their priests and their monks, and they became ascetic, and he started to abstain from the good things of the dunya. Allah described them, and he said about them, rahbaniyatan ibtadu'uha ma katabnaha alayhim. Rahbaniya, aestheticism, that they innovated. I never wrote this. I never decreed this on them. I never legislated this upon them. For a man not to get married, for the nun not to get married, for the people not to eat and to enjoy the tayyibat and the good things that Allah Ta'ala has provided. This innovation of the dunya, no problem with that. We challenge you fathers, mothers, and we encourage you young brothers, Ismail, Yaqub, you young brothers, we challenge you to invent new things that Bani Adam are going to benefit from. And the deen can benefit from it as well, the Muslims. Innovations in the dunya that enhance the quality of life of human beings. And people of ignorance, they always come with this mad, asinine, retarded argument. You people, you don't like innovations. The car is an innovation. The microphone is an innovation. This is an innovation. That's an innovation. No, we don't have any problem with that. The deen of Allah has no problem with that. The innovation that the deen has a problem with is the innovation in the deen. So the innovation in the deen is the thing that someone is doing, he's introducing, he invented something that was not in the religion before. It wasn't legislated by Allah or His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the reason why the person is doing it is to get close to Allah. That's the innovation that we're talking about. That is not the innovation that Umar radiallahu anhu, when he said, when he gathered the people behind one imam in the month of Ramadan, ni'ma bid'ah hadihi. This is a good bid'ah. He didn't mean that. He wasn't getting close to Allah Azza wa Jal. His companions were not getting close to Allah Azza wa Jal by making that Salatul Taraweeh in Jama'ah, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam preceded them to that. During his lifetime, they did that. So it can't be an innovation in the deen, not in the deen, the religious connotation and the meaning of innovation. Concerning the issue of innovation, Khwani, there are three types of innovations in the deen, three types. The first type is the innovation that is the bid'ah al-haqiqiyah, the bid'ah that is totally, absolutely an innovation from every angle. It has no dalil connected to it whatsoever. Not from the kitab, not from the sunnah, and not from the ijma' of the Muslims. It has absolutely no dalil connected at all. Someone is just coming up with something, making up something. Like the one who believes that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam never died. Like the one who believes that his imam is ma'soom. Someone other than Rasulullah is ma'soom, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ali ibn Abi Talib, Abdul Qadir al-Jailani, your sheikh, your imam, the one who you're following. We heard Salafi people saying that a sheikh is ma'soom in the minhaj. He never makes mistakes in the minhaj. And that's absolutely crazy, retarded, asinine. There were companions, radiallahu anhum, who made statements mistakenly concerning the aqidah of Allah Azza wa Jalla. They made statements of shirk mistakenly, and they're the most intelligent of the people. They were with the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They understood this Quran when it was revealed. And here, you're going to tell us 1432 that the sheikh doesn't make any mistakes in the minhaj? The one who comes and he tells us, you must have a madhhab. You must follow a madhhab. If you ask him, as we've been commanded to say to the Ahlul Kitab, who make all of these claims, you must believe Isa ibn Maryam. You must be a Christian. We've been commanded. Say to them, Hatu burhanakum. in kuntum sadiqin. Prove that I have to have a madhhab. He can't prove it because it has no dalil from close or far. Absolutely no dalil. So it is the innovation that is the haqiqiyya, al-bid'ah al-haqiqiyya, rejecting the qadr, rejecting it. I don't believe in the qadr. You're not going to bring an ayat that allows you to disbelieve in the qadr. Your mind will allow you. Rejecting the single hadith, the hadith ahad. If you want me to accept the hadith, it has to have two or three more people who narrated it. If the hadith, innama al-a'malu bin-niyat, was narrated only by one companion, I'm not going to take it, especially if it's in aqidah or ahkam. You have no ayat that will support that, not a single ayat. That is the first type of innovation. And this innovation has crept into every nook and cranny. That is the Muslim identity today. The second type of innovation is the innovation that is idafiyya, al-bid'ah al-idafiyya. That is the innovation. It's lesser in degree than the first one in that it has a dalil for it from one angle, but the way it's being done and understood on the other side makes it an innovation. And this is a real big problem with the ummah. It has some dalil. The man wants to come and he wants to make the dhikr of Allah. So he takes the ayat of the Quran, Ala bi dhikrillahi tatma'innul qulub. Using and by the dhikr of Allah, the hearts become tranquil. So he sits and he says, huwa, 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 Allah, 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 Allah. You say, akhi, that's an innovation. He said, Allah said the dhikr of Allah. He has an ayah. He has a hadith. Majtama'a qawmin fi baytin min buyutillah yatluna kitab Allahi yatadarasunuhu fima baynahum illa nazalat alayhim sakina. There are never a group of people come in one of the houses of Allah and they read the book of Allah and they study it between themselves except that Sakina comes down upon them. So he says, we're in the masjid and we're in the circle and the lights are down and the bukhur, the incense are burning. And the word huwa, huwa Allah, kul huwa Allah, huwa is in the Quran. Huwa, 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 Allah, 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 Allah. And I'm using the dalil. Yeah, from one angle, what he's saying, that ayah does say that. But the one who the ayah was revealed on, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and the ones who he spoke to and he related to it, and they heard him recite it. They were behind him, and they used to recite it. They never came together in the masjid and understood and practiced that ayah like that. So therefore, it is a bid'ah al-idafiyya. There is a salat called Salat al-Raghaib, big salat. The first Friday of Rajab, you pray 12 rak'at. In the 12 rak'at, you read certain things. It has a dalil from one side. Has a dalil. The Nabi told us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as-salat khayru mawdu'. The salat is the best thing that you can do. So in the month of Rajab, a sacred month, they want to do this salat raga'ib, a big prayer. And if you came to the people of a Sufiya and you told them this is a bid'ah, they would want to cut your head off. The Sufi Sheikh, there's someone of the Sunnah who's trying to educate the Muslims, telling them innovations will destroy you. So Kabira from the Kaba'ir, all he has to do is say, hey, Jama'ah, you know that man? He doesn't like Rasulullah. He doesn't believe in his birthday. This man over here, he doesn't believe in Salat. He doesn't like Salat. Meaning Salat al-Raghaib. And then the people say, what? He doesn't love Rasulullah, the birthday? He doesn't like Salat? Meaning Salat al-Raghaib. And then that's enough for them to put their fingers in their ears, not to listen to you again, or to even take the sword out and kill you. So it has a dalil from an angle, but from the way it's being understood, it's not correct. The Shabbarat. Shabbarat is a bid'ah idafiyya. It's a bid'ah idafiyya. Yes, the 15th of Sha'ban is virtuous. It's a special day, a special night in the deen of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And even some of the Salaf did certain things on this night, like the great Tabi Maqhul and other than him. May Allah have mercy upon them. But our example is not what one or two or three individuals did after the companions. Our example is what Allah revealed in the Quran, what His Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam called to him was upon in his authentic sunnah, and what the companions agreed upon and what they did. And then after that, we look and we investigate what people are saying, what they're doing, not taken away from the positions of the tabi'een and the atba' tabi'een. Second type of innovation, category, the bid'ah al-idafiyah. Has a dalil from one side, but the way that dalil is being understood, the way it's being used, the way that people are dealing with it is not correct. After the salah, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. And then everyone raises their hand and they start making dua. The imam is making dua and we're saying ameen, ameen. There's dalil for that. There's dalil that after the salat, that's one of the times that the dua is accepted. Generally speaking, Allah Ta'ala is hayy, kareem, yastahi and yarfa abdu ilayhi yadayhi fayurduhuma sifran khaibatain. Allah is shy and Allah is generous. He is shy that if you raise your hands and make dua, He's shy in a way that befits His majesty. He's shy not to give you what you're asking for. That's a dalil, to raise your hand. But to raise your hand after the salat all the time in jama'ah with the imam reading like that has its dalil from one angle. But from the other angle, the way it's being understood in practice, the Prophet didn't do it. Sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wasallam. It is an innovation. And when someone tells you this is innovation, don't come and say he doesn't believe in dua. Don't say that. Don't say he doesn't believe in dua in the jama'ah, because there is a dua in jama'ah that's permissible. When we're praying the qiyamul layl, when we're praying the tahajjud, when we're praying the taraweeh, and the imam is making the qunut, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would make dua, and his companions would say ameen, ameen, and they would raise their hands. But are you after the salat, jum'ah, dhuhr, asr, maghrib, isha, al-fajr, is that qiyamul layl? Is that the qunut at that time? So that is the bid'ah, that is idafiyah. The adhan inside of the masjid is an innovation. Whatever masjid you go to, if the mu'adhan is inside of the masjid, that is an innovation, and it's been ruled as being an innovation with the scholars of al-Islam. Why? That's because there's dalil for the adhan. But the way it's being done and the place it's being done is a problem. They call it the tahsil al-hasil. Tahsil al-hasil. Like if you say the wooden tree. What tree you want me to cut down? That one over there, the wooden one, the wooden one. Everyone knows that the tree is made out of wood. What do you think, there's a tree made out of steel? It is tahsil al-hasil. Making the adhan inside of the masjid for the people inside of the masjid defeats the purpose. The reason for the adhan is for the people outside of the masjid, outside. The reason for the adhan is for the mu'adhin to come yawm al-qiyamah and everything that heard him make the claim of the tawheed of Allah and the risal of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and calling the creation to al-falah. Calling the creation to a salat. Every rock, every tree, every bird, every ant, every human being, every jinn will come yawm al-qiyamah and bear witness for that mu'adhin. He's inside of the masjid and that doesn't happen. None of that happens. He's given the adhan for people inside of the masjid. Now we know an innovation like this, al-idafiyah, it has a lot to do with sometimes city ordinances and so forth and so on. But if the person went outside at the door of the masjid, although it's not loud and it's not bothering the people, Allahu A'lam, how much reward that man is going to receive, even if people didn't hear it. Allahu Ta'ala commanded Ibrahim, أَذِّن فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ. أَذِّن فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ. Ibrahim, make the adhan and call the people to the hajj. When you go to hajj, look at how many people have responded to the call of Ibrahim. وَمَا قَدُرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. They didn't consider Allah the correct way, the way He's supposed to be considered. You just do what you've been told and leave the rest to Allah Azza wa Jalla. So all of those are examples, and there are many more, of the bid'ah al-idafiyyah. And as I mentioned to you, this bid'ah, the issue of bid'ah, has reached into every nook and cranny of the Muslim identity, even with people who are on the sunnah. The third type of innovation, ikhwani, is the innovation that is called at-tarkiyah, al-bid'atu tarkiyah. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did things, and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he avoided certain things. Religiously, he didn't do those things. For you to come and to do something that he had the ability to do, but he left it, you do that thing, that is an innovation. And there are many examples of that. For you to avoid something that he had the ability to do, you do it, and he had the ability to do it, that is an innovation. And the other side holds true as well. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had the ability to tell the people and himself to stand before Allah and say, I intend to make Salat al-Dhuhr behind this imam, following him in this wajib salat and so forth and so on, and making your niyyah like that. He had the ability, he didn't do it. He left it, so you should leave it. To do it is an innovation. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we just prayed the Eid prayer. We just prayed the Eid. He doesn't, during his life, ever make the adhan for the two Eids. You come and you say, we need to let the people know. It's a salat in Jama'at. It's similar to Jum'ah. Let's do the Eid prayer. He didn't make the adhan, so we shouldn't make the adhan. Simple as. Simple as. If you have the ability to go outside and pray that Eid prayer outside, and you choose to do it inside because of convenience, just it's easy. It's easy. That is an innovation. As for the people who don't have the ability, it's too cold, it's too wet, no safety and security, then out of necessity, you don't do it. But the innovation is, he had the ability to pray the Eid prayer inside of his masjid, but he made it a point to go outside all the time. All the time. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, when he came in the masjid for the khutbatul Jum'ah, he wouldn't pray two rakats when he came into the masjid. As the imam, he just went on the minbar and started, assalamu alaikum, sat down and gave the khutbah. An imam comes, he prays two rakah. Because of the hadith, pray two rakats before you sit down. That's an innovation, because he left those two rakats and he knew what he was doing. In this case, you should leave what he left, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When we were traveling for the Hajj, we told the people, hey, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came as a rahmah, and he taught the people from the etiquette of traveling, is that you should abandon all of the sunnah prayers. The only sunnah prayers when he traveled that he didn't abandon were the two rakats of al-fajr and the witr prayer. The nawafil connected to dhuhr, asr, maghrib, isha, he never prayed them. His companions used to pray with some of their students, and they would shorten the prayer, combine the prayer. After shortening the prayer, the man would get up to pray sunnahs. Salaamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Salaamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. The student would get up to pray sunnahs. Abdullah ibn Umar would say, what are you about to do? He said, I want to pray sunnahs. He said, take the sunnah of the Nabi, is better for you. Why do we shorten? Why do we combine? Takhfifin lakum, to make it light and easy. Why get up and make sunnahs? We told the people this over and over again, but they were feeling good. They were feeling, if I don't make this nawafin, I'm not doing the right thing. No, he left those prayers at those times. When you make Umrah, Abdullah, the Nabi made four Umrahs, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, four. And in each Umrah, he along with his companions, radiallahu anhum, once they went to Mecca, they never went to the masjid called Masjid al-Tan'im, the Masjid of Aisha. They never made Umrah and then came out of Ihram one day, 2 days went by, and then they went to that masjid, put Ihram on and came back again, made another Umrah, went out, came back again. Umrah for my mother, Umrah for my father, Umrah for my cousin, Umrah for my... They never did that. One Umrah. And they could have made multiple Umrahs if they wanted to, but instead of making multiple Umrahs, they would just make more and more Tawaf. It's better for you to stick with the Sunnah and put your niyyah and your desire to do more, put that on the side. So the point here, Ikhwani, is the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he did things and he left things. For you to abandon something that he left religiously, person says, Wallahi, I'm not going to do any more sunnahs. I'm just going to do what's wajib, getting close to Allah by doing that. That's an innovation because the Prophet did sunnahs. Now, if you don't do sunnahs because of laziness, or you're just not a man of doing the nawafil, no one can blame you for that. Although Yawm al-Qiyam, everyone's going to wish he did more. But the person who says, I'm going to get close to Allah by not doing any sunnahs. Nah, this is a problem. You all know the three men who were companions of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The one said, I'll never get married to women. I'm going to fast all day. And the third one said, I'm going to pray all night. The Prophet told them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who's this? What's the problem? People are saying this and parents saying that. I fast and I break my fast. I pray and I go to sleep. And I marry women. Anyone who abandons my sunnah, he's not from me. You can't abandon something that the Nabi used to do religiously. You can't. يَا أَيُّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُحَرِّمُوا طَيِّبَاتِ مَا أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Oh, you who believe, don't make haram the good things that Allah has made permissible for you. وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُعْتَدِينَ. And don't go overboard. Allah doesn't love those who go overboard. One of the ways of going overboard and exceeding the limits is for you to think that you can do something in a way that's better than the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by either doing something that he abandoned or abandoning something that he used to do. So those are the three types of innovations. Three types. Al-bid'atul haqiqiyya has no dalil whatsoever. The Rasul is from the Nur of Allah. He's Hazir Nazir. No dalil. Second innovation, al-idafiyya. One side has a dalil, but the way it's being understood, practiced, the mold, the number, the place, it's wrong. Number three, the bid'ah of abandonment. You are doing something that he left off, something that he abandoned, or you're leaving off something that he used to do, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. And one of the reasons why these types of innovations are a problem is because, again, the one who does it, he is mu'tadi, like the ayah said. Do not make haram the tayyibat that Allah Ta'ala has made halal. وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا. Don't be a mu'tadi. Don't exceed the limits. Innovations, they are a prime example of someone going beyond his limit. Allah Ta'ala mentioned, this is the problem with innovations. أَمْ لَهُمْ شُرَكَ شَرَعُ لَهُمْ مِنَ الدِّينِ مَا لَمْ يَأْذِنْ بِهِ اللَّهِ. Do they have legislators? Do they have partners along with Allah who has legislated for them in the religion that which Allah didn't sanction? When you do an innovation and you're saying, I'm going to do this, you're in essence legislating in the religion. You're claiming that Allah forgot. You're bringing something to the table that's beneficial, that Allah didn't mention, that His Prophet didn't mention, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمْ الْإِسْلَامَ الدِّينَ. Today, I have completed for you your religion. Ummat al-Islam. This ayat of the Quran is a simple ayat to understand. What's the implications and the meaning of the ayat? On this day, I have completed for you your religion. And I have completed my favor upon you. And I am pleased to choose for you as a religion, al-Islam. Someone comes and he says, I'm going to introduce something or I'm going to subtract something from what is the deen. He is in essence saying, no, the religion is not complete. The religion is not complete. And that's what Al-Imam Malik used to say. Anyone who does an innovation, this is what he's saying about this ayat. He's saying, no, Allah, you didn't complete the ayat. You didn't complete the deen. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ صِدْقًا وَعَدْلًا. The word of your Lord, the religion of your Lord, the kalim of your Lord, it has been completed with sidq and adl. What Allah said, sadaqallahu al-azim. This is sidq. It doesn't need your kadhib. It's not in need of you coming to try to embellish it or enhance it. Wa tammat kalimatu rabbika sidqan wa adla. This is complete. With truthfulness, What the Prophet said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was articulate. It was compelling. It was clear. Doesn't need you or me or any other intelligent, sincere wali from the holy of Allah coming to add. The companions didn't add anything. They didn't change anything. Allah Ta'ala mentioned and he described the companions in the Quran. من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما آهدوا الله عليه فمنهم من قضى نحبه منهم من ينتظر وما بدلوا تبديلا. From the believers are men, رضي الله عنهم أجمعين. They completed their contract that they had with Allah. From them are those who went out and completed the contract and they were killed في سبيل الله. And there are others who are still waiting to go, to spread this deen and to lose their lives, fi sabilillah, and to do everything big and small, easy and difficult, to relay this message. And then Allah said, وَمَا بَدُّلُوا تَبْدِيلًا. And they didn't change anything. So even after the death of Al-Mustafa Al-Amin, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no one could come and say, what about the hadith? Take my sunnah and the sunnah of the Khulafa Al-Rashideen. Didn't they do add on? La. They didn't add anything on. Because based on the Quran and the Sunnah, what they did was supported by all of the companions. And that is in the Quran and the Sunnah, that the ijma', especially of the companions, is a dalil. So when Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu brought this Quran together, it's sanctioned by the Quran and by the Sunnah. When Umar radiallahu anhu, when he made the adhan, the first adhan of Friday, in the marketplace, and then the second adhan, outside of the masjid, on the minaret, when it was time to pray, no, the Prophet didn't do that, but that is sanctioned in the Quran and in the Sunnah. Because the ijma', all the companions saw it, and they allowed it. And the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَن تَجْتَمِعَ أُمَّتِي عَلَى الضَّلَالَةِ. My ummah will never agree about something that's wrong, especially those companions, especially. That's in the Sunnah, those two adhans. Those two adhans are in the Quran. وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. What the Prophet gives you, take it. What he prohibited you from, leave it. And he told us, take what the Khulafa Rashidin said and what they did. Not individually, not when they made mistakes, but when they did and said things that were supported by the Quran and the Sunnah, when they did and said things that were supported by all of the companions. It is a dalil. So the shahid and the point here is, وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ صِدْقًا وَعَدْلًا. The word of your Lord, the deen of your Lord, it is complete with sidq and adl. What he commanded you to do, what he made haram, all of that is justice. Doesn't need you, doesn't need me, doesn't need communism, doesn't need capitalism, socialism, fulan and alan, to come and to put justice in our religion. Just back up and pump your brakes. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he told the people, ittabi'u wa la tabtadi'u, laqad kufitum. Follow and don't introduce anything. Don't introduce anything. No Mawlid al-Nabawi, no Shabbarat, don't introduce anything. Because what has been left for you is enough. Radiallahu anhu. That word of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud should be written in gold, literally. Melt the gold, take a pen and write it. Follow and do not innovate. Don't introduce, because what has been left for you is more than enough. It's the problem with innovation. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ikhwani, said in a number of ahadith that go to show, when you innovate, you add and you subtract, you are making takdhib of the Prophet that we claim that we love, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said in an authentic hadith, إِنَّهُ لَمْ يَكُنْ نَبِيًّا قَبْلِ إِلَّا كَانَ حَقًّا عَلَيْهِ أَنْ يَدُلُّ أُمَّتِهِ عَرَى خَيْرِ مَا يَعْلَمُهُ لَهُ وَيَنْظُرُهُمْ شَرَّ مَا يَعْلَمُهُ لَهُ. There was never a prophet before me, except that it was wajib upon him. It was the haq that he had to tell his ummah about all of the good that he knew was for them, and that he had to warn them of all of the evil. When we say we believe in Allah and the Malaik and the Kutub and the Rasul, Yawm al-Akh and the Qadr, when we say we believe in the prophets, we have to believe that the prophets do not talk based on their whims, that the prophets are the best people, that the prophets, when they go to sleep, their dreams are wahi, revelation, that the prophets don't make major sins, that the prophets are human beings, that the prophets die. There are many things we have to believe. Some of them are better than others. Many things we have to believe. One of the things we have to believe is that every prophet was Amin, everyone. As Hadith said, there was never a prophet before me except it was wajib upon him to tell his people all of the good that he knew for them and to warn them of all of the evil. He said in another Hadith, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ma taraktu shay'an mimma amarakum Allahu bihi illa waqad amartukum bihi. He said, I never left anything. Shay'an is nakira, without the ala ta'rif. Shay'an is general, comprehensive. He said, I never left anything. Never left something. He said, I never left anything that Allah commanded me to tell you people except that I told you. And there was nothing that Allah Azza wa Jal commanded you and made it prohibited for you to do it, except that I warned you of it. مَا مِنْ شَيْءٍ يُقَرِّبُكُمْ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ إِلَىٰ أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ وَلَا شَيْءٍ يُقَرِّبُكُمْ إِلَى النَّارِ إِلَىٰ نَهِيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ. There is nothing that will cause you people to go close to Jannah except that I told you about it. And there is nothing that will cause you to come close to the fire except that I warned you of it. أَلَا إِنِّي تَرَكْتُكُمْ عَلَى الْبَيْضَى لَيْلُهَا كَالنَّهَارِهَا لَا يَزِغُ عَنْهَا إِلَّا هَالِي. I have left you people on something that is white and clear. Its nighttime is like its day. No one will go astray and be destroyed except the one who leaves it. So the point here, Ikhwani, the mushkila with the innovation is a person is making takdeeb of Allah. He's making takdeeb of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who we claim we love. The innovation is for him. And that's because Allah has clearly established that the religion is complete and the Prophet has come Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he's informed us that he didn't leave anything. And here we come and we say, no, I have to add on. During the Hajj of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, as I've mentioned in this masjid many of times, he gathered all of those companions together and he said, after telling the other companions, make them quiet. Make everyone quiet. Make everyone be quiet. Great multitude of people. They never had these numbers before. Not in any jihad. They never had so many people in one place. So it was noisy. Hajj. One of the things he mentioned on that big day of Hajj, make the people quiet. Make the people quiet. He said a number of things to them. I heard that the khutbah was about his last sermon. After finishing all of the kalam, he said, okay, people, what are you going to say about me, Yawm al-Qiyamah, when you meet Allah? They said, we bear witness that you relayed the message. We bear witness. We're going to bear witness that you left us on a religion that is the Muhajjat al-Bayda. It is clear. His night is like his day. 1,432 years. 1,442 years since you first started to this very day, your religion is clear. What are you going to say? I'm going to say, you relayed the message. Adayt al-amana. He put his blessed finger up to the sky where Allah is over his seven heavens, over his throne in a way that befits his majesty. Innovation. Allah is everywhere. Don't say that Allah has a place. That's what Allah established in the Quran. Innovation in every nook and cranny of the Islamic identity, the Muslim today. He put his finger up and he said, Allahumma shahad, bear witness on these people to my right. Allahumma shahad, bear witness on these people in the middle. Allahumma shahad, bear witness to these people, on these people to my left. The best of the people after the prophets and the messengers. Salawatullahi wa salamu alayhim ajma'een. The best of the people, the companions, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, all of those ulama who he told them in a hadith, أنتم في الزمان كثير علمائه قليل خطبائه من ترك عشر دينه فقد هوى وسيأتي زمان كثير خطبائه قليل علمائه من تمسك بعشر الدين فقد اهتدى. You companions are living during a time where there are many ulama. Many of you know this religion. Al-Imam Ahmed, Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, Al-Imam Al-Shafi, Al-Imam Malik. They couldn't compare in terms of knowledge, deen, taqwa, awareness, wara. They couldn't compare to those companions. As I mentioned to you 1,000 times, our aqidah. That lady from the Ghamidiya tribe, the Ghamisi tribe, she committed adultery and was stoned to death. She's better than all four of those imams. That Bedouin man who came in the masjid and urinated and put najasa in the second best masjid in Islam, he's better than those four imams. That man is in Jannah. What about the ulama? You people are living in the time, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, many, many ulama, and only a few khutaba, khatibs, only a few. Anyone from amongst you who leaves, you just leave a tenth of your deen, you'll be astray. If you don't pray Qiyamul Layl, Abu Bakr, if you don't fast Mondays and Thursdays, if you don't make Umrah and Hajj multiple times, you're going to be astray. Because the bar and the standard is high during your time. And there's going to come a time when there are many khutaba, many khatibs, but only a few ulama. Whoever holds on to only a tenth of his religion will be guided aright. He doesn't make Qiyamul Layl, doesn't fast Monday and Thursday. He never makes Hajj in his whole life. Never make Hajj. And if he does, he makes it one time. That's it. That's enough. Because the standard is lower. The standard is lower. So when he said, what are you going to say about me? Those uqala, ulama, hukama, they said, you relay the message. When they said that, that kalam of those companions is heavy in the scales. Don't let some latecomer come today, 1,442 years later, talking about, I need to introduce this and I need to introduce that. Not only that, ikhwani, not only that, but even the kuffar, during the time of those companions, realized this. And the ayah that we mentioned, Al-Yawma Akmaltu Lakum Deenakum, the Yahudi said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, there's an ayah that has been revealed to you Muslims. If it came down upon us, the Yahud, we'd have made that a day of an Eid celebration. He said, what ayah? The Yahudi said, the statement, Al-Yawm Akmaltu Lakum Deenakum. Their religion is not complete. Their religion was not complete. Muhammad came, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to complete their religion. He knew the importance of it. Another example, non-Muslim, Yahudi. He came to Salman al-Farisi, he said, لَقَدْ عَلَّمَكُمْ نَبِيُّكُمْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى الْخَرَاءَ. Your Nabi taught you everything. He even taught you how to go to the toilet. He even taught you how to go to the toilet. And he said, that's right. And then he went on to explain to him some of the etiquettes of how to go to the toilet. Don't face the Qibla when you relieve yourself from the front or the back. Don't clean yourself with your right hands. Don't use this, don't use that. Don't spit towards the Qibla. All of these mundane affairs, simple things. What hand to give with, what hand to take with. What hand not to give with, what hand not. Mundane things. You see, you go to sleep at night and you have a dream. Turn over on this side. Don't speak about it. Say, A'udhu Billah. Mundane things. And do you think now this same religion is going to come and remain silent about how to express our love for Al-Mustafa, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? That it's going to require you or me, Amr Bakr Zayd, to come and tell us, let's do the Mawlid al-Nabawi. Let's show our appreciation. La wallahi, it's not in need of that. Simple issue. This is not a daras ikhwani or a dhikr to bash Brawis, Diobandis, ikhwanis, Tablighis, Sufis, Qutubis, Sururis, Takfiris. No, this is a lecture to remind you. Innovations have crept into every nook and cranny. The way the Muslim greets his brother is ibadah in al-Islam. And we know it's ibadah because if two Muslims meet and they shake hands, their sins fall off of them the way the leaves fall off of a tree. That's an authentic hadith. So when we add on to it and we're doing things like that, we are adding on to an ibadah that has been explained to us in detail, nook and cranny. Nothing has been left out. No place, the awam, general people, and the khawas, ulama. That's not me taking a shot at scholars. We respect the position of ulama. But they are also part of the time that we're living in. So concerning the issue of innovations, Allah has established the argument against us. Now, to speed this thing along, what are some of the reasons that the people fall into innovations? Why? There are many reasons, but at the top of the list is the reason of ignorance, al-jahl, ignorance. And ignorance, ikhwani, it is manifested in many ways concerning innovation. One of the ways of ignorance is at-taqleed, al-a'ma. At-taqleed means you follow someone's opinion and you don't know his dalil. You're ignorant. You don't know what's the dalil. He doesn't do raf'u al-yadain. If you ask him why, he says, I don't know. It's my madhhab. It's what I was taught. That's taqleed. He doesn't know. It is not always necessarily bad, as I mentioned a number of times. Sometimes you have to make taqleed because you don't have enough knowledge to delve into the issue. But there are those issues that you have the ability to comprehend and to appreciate the truth from the falsehood. Someone comes and says, you must have a madhhab. He's just blindly following. Someone comes and tells you the Imam al-Mahdi al-Muntadhar that we've been waiting for in Tehran for so many years to come out of a grave. That innovation, what are you talking about? That's just me blindly following what my forefathers said, and that's it. Has nothing to do with the religion. I'm just blindly following what people said and what people are doing. If you ask the people, hey, this dua after the salat, why are you doing it? I'm a new Muslim, I'm a revert. Just show me where it is so that I can appreciate it and do it with knowledge. Didn't Allah Ta'ala describe Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and those who follow him as worshiping Allah and giving dawah ala basira? Qul, hadhihi sabili adu'u ila Allahi ala basiratin ana wa man ittaba'ani. Tell them, ya Muhammad, tell them, this is my way. This is my way. So follow it. I call to Allah, me and those who follow me with knowledge. Where's this dalil? Where's it at? They're going to tell you, this is just what we've always done in this masjid. We've always done this in this masjid. As opposed to coming to you and just showing you, where's the proof? So taqleed is one of the manifestations of ignorance. Another manifestation of ignorance is the lack of knowledge of the many weak hadith that are the basis and the source of many of these innovations. Like this Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam being created from the nur of Allah. The hadith said that Rasulullah said to Jabir Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, وَرَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمَا أَوَّلُ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ نُورَ نَبِيِّكَ يَا جَابِرُ. The very first thing that Allah created, ya Jabir, was the nur of your Nabi. Based upon that, people understand he's from the nur of Allah. That hadith is fabricated. لَوْلَاكَ مَا خَلَقْتُ الْأَفْلَاكَ. If it wasn't for you, if it wasn't for you, ya Muhammad, Allah is saying to Rasulullah, if it wasn't for you, if it wasn't for you, I wouldn't have created this creation. The creation is created because of him. Hadith is fabricated. So based upon those many fabricated hadith, keep your crazy people away from the masjid, keep the kids away from the masjid. From the innovation is for us to build a masjid and it has no facilities for women to come and pray. The Nabi had a masjid, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that had a facilities for women. And they had a special door called Bab al-Nisa, the door of the Nisa. So the innovation is to leave off something that he did. He had a masjid. In his masjid was a place for women. And the way we build it is no place for women because it's better for them to stay at home. It's better for them to stay at home. The one who said that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, also provided for them a place in their masjid. So when you see a masjid that has been built like that, you're on the administration of a masjid that the people are going to build a new masjid, you should try to say something. Because to build a masjid for the sole purpose of only men having access to it is an innovation. And then we rely on weak hadith. Keep the women from the masjid. Keep the women, the children, and the majnun people from the masjid. Fabricated. Ignorance. Another manifestation of the ignorance, ikhwani, are the ignorant leaders who we take as teachers, who we listen to. People were teaching and telling us things about their dreams that they saw. Rasulullah came to me and told me Christmas is okay. So you people should do Christmas. The Nabi came to me and he told me he was upset, angry with all of you people because you didn't give me more money to help my program and my project. There's a Sufi sheikh, I won't mention his name, but he's very old now. He is in charge of the Naqshbandiya Tariqa. Go on a YouTube. The man is old and he's cursing using very foul language, very bad language. And the people are laughing. He said, I'm from the awliya of Allah. I reached the age of 80. I'm over 80. And Allah has allowed us to do whatever we want to do. Then he narrates a weak fabricated hadith. The sheikh of this of the tariqah, we get up and we go and pray salah. He stays there. We come back and he said, look, I went to Mecca. And I prayed in Mecca and I came back. While you people went, say, Sheikh, where's the dalil for that? And he gives you some made up hadith. It's a problem. So we take these leaders like this. As the Nabi says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna min ashrat al-sa'a, and yultamis al-ilm and al-asagir. From the signs of the hour, is that knowledge will be searched for from the asagir. The asagir. From Sagir, Asagir, Al Imam Abdullah ibn Mubarak, the Muhaddith, the Amir al Mu'mineen fil Hadith, he said, the Asagir is Ahl al Bid'ah. Knowledge will be searched for and acquired from people of innovation. Sheikh, what's the meaning of the dream? I have black magic, give me white magic. And then they mislead the people. Nallaha, La yaqbid al ilm. انتزاع ينتزعه من العباد ولكن يقبض العلم بقبض العلماء حتى إذا لم يبقي عالم اتخذ الناس رؤوسا جهالا فسئلوا فأفتوا بغير علم فضلوا وأضلوا. Allah is not going to take the knowledge one time out of the hearts of the people, just strip it from them at one time, but he'll take the knowledge away by causing the scholars to die. And if there doesn't remain any real scholar, ulama, by the meaning of the word, then the people will take ignorant people as their leaders and their heads. So those ignorant people will be asked questions and they will answer those questions and they will go astray and the other people will go astray. This is something that has happened even to Salafi people. Ignorant people are in charge. Ignorant people are the ones who are saying, I was told by someone thiqa that you are this and you are that. Mubtadi, you mubtadi, you mubtadi, mubtadi. Who are you? La umma laka. Who are you? Wallahi, who are you? All of us. Who are we? Who are we? To give those kind of fatwas. Leave issues like that to scholars of Islam. You have a problem with this brother or this brother, this masjid or that masjid. Take it to the ulama. But which ulama? Any scholar? The scholar who's on your side? The scholar who has been affected by the disease and with the disease? No. Take it to the scholars. No, we want to put ourselves forward. And this is one of the main reasons why as Salafia, Salafis, we have all these problems. Ignorant people are in front, talking. That doesn't mean, ikhwani, that you brothers don't have the right to give dawah in Allah. Give dawah in Allah. But give dawah based upon what you know. Based upon what you know. If one of our brothers has died, as it happened when we went to Hajj, I still see the day as if it was yesterday. We were about to make preparations to go to Mecca. I was coming down the stairs after we prayed Salat al-Asr. We didn't got our stuff. I'm coming downstairs. As soon as I hit the floor, someone called me and said, did you hear that that brother died? It was like a lightning bolt. Because we kept telling the people about aspects of the deen and also aspects, be careful, because there is an accident waiting to happen around every corner. You get hit by a car. You know how it is in our countries. Pakistan, I know some people who they die, their limbs are cut off because there was a live wire. So when he went to hit the nail, it went in the wire and it was electrocuted. So what happens in our countries? Accident waiting to happen. When we heard that, we all were amazed. Okay. If you get an opportunity to talk about that to non-Muslims, don't call to a sect. Call to al-Islam and make al-Islam beautiful and understood by the people. Don't take it as an opportunity to call to Green Lane Masjid. Call to the beauty of the religion of al-Islam. Ignorant people. Wallahu musta'an. From the reasons, ikhwani, that we have this issue of innovation is that people follow what is known as the mutashabih from the Quran and the Sunnah, those ambiguous things that are not clear. In Ali Imran, the beginning of the surah, third ayat, Allah Ta'ala mentioned about himself, huwa alladhi anzala alayka al-kitab minhu ayatun muhkamatun hunna umul kitab wa ukharu mutashabihat. فأما الذين في قلوبهم زيغ فيتبعون ما تشابه منه ابتغاء الفتنة وابتغاء تأويله وما يعلم تأويله إلا الله والراسخون في العلم يقولون آمنا به كل من عند ربنا وما يذكر إلا أولي الألباب. Allah is the one who revealed to you this Quran, ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In this Quran are ayat that are basic and fundamental. They constitute the mother of the book. They're the majority of the book. And there are other ayat that are ambiguous and they're not clear. As for those who have a disease in their heart, the Tabi'in used to say, those who have the disease in their heart, people of innovation, people of doubt. As for those who have a zayr in their heart, they go after what is ambiguous, seeking to make fitna, seeking to get its explanation. How does Allah come down? How this, how that? As for those who have knowledge, they, the ones who are establishing the deen, they say, look, we believe in all of this book. All of it is from our Lord. And no one will reflect and comprehend except the one who is labib. He's intelligent. Aisha, radiallahu anha, our mother, she said about this ayat that the Nabi read this whole ayat. And then he said to his companion, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمْ أَلَّذِينَ يَتَّبِعُونَ مَا تَشَابَى مِنْهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ سَمَّهُمَ اللَّهُ فَاحْذَرُوهُمْ. If you see anyone going after the ambiguous ayat of the Quran, if you see them, then these are the ones that Allah was referring to in this ayat. So beware of them. Beware of the people of innovation. There's a certain way to deal with them. They're from your relatives. They're Shiite, Sufis, Brewis. There's a way to deal with them. And that way of dealing with them is also established in the Quran and the Sunnah. Some of them you cut them off totally. And some of them you continue to give them dawah. It's the religion that helps us understand how to deal with them. But don't be of the two extremes. One extreme is, it's okay, it's just an innovation. La, that's a big thing. The bid'ah is a kabira from the kabair. Praying in that masjid, praying behind him, giving salams, marrying to his family, marrying your family into him, all of those are big issues. But it has its dawabit, it has its shurut, conditions, mandates. So the people follow the mutashabih of the Quran. Ar-Rahman, ala al-arsh istawa. Ar-Rahman, he went over his throne. Al-Istiwa. What is the meaning of Istiwa? In the Arabic language, it means to overpower and to conquer. Yeah, it does mean that. It does mean that. And then before you know it, the person says, nah, Allah, he didn't, from the mutashabihat. Although it's not mutashabi, but they make it like that. From the reasons, ikhwani, and there are many, but I just use this one as the very last one, is when the people put their intellect before the Quran and the Sunnah. I'm in Mecca and I'm going to make Umrah. It's a golden opportunity. I'm going to go to Masjid al-Tan'im and I'm going to go back and forth and back and forth. How can anything be wrong with that? How can anything be wrong with the khatam and the yarmi? We're cooking food, we're inviting people. Those three companions who said, what does the Nabi do in his homes when he's here? They said, he doesn't do much. He's like that. They said, man, we can do more than that. They put their intellect at that moment before the text. When the text came to them, they realized we were wrong. Lastly, the dangers of innovation. There are many, many, but just to name a few and we end with this. From the dangers of innovation is what Al-Imam Al-Barbahari said, and I know that our students have memorized that when we came to the point of innovations. He said, beware of the sagha'il muhdathat. Beware of every small innovation, because every small innovation ultimately turned into something that was big. Celebrating the Prophet's birthday, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, started off with something small, just coming together, reading the Quran and making a little food, giving it to the masakin. That's how it started. The Khawarij, people who kill Muslims, blow up planes and trains, Muslims and non-Muslims. The dawah of the Khawarij, it started out as small rocks, small pebbles. People in the masjid just taking rocks saying, subhanallah, subhanallah, subhanallah. And then the leader of the circle would say, now say with those rocks, Allahu Akbar. Then they, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. That's what it started out with. But it ended with them pulling those same people, drawing their swords on the companions and saying that the companions were kuffar. To the point that they took the son of the companion, Abdullah ibn Khabbab and Arat, killed him, stabbed him, and then took his wife, opened up her belly and took the baby out and cut the baby's neck. That started off with a pebble, a little rock. Every innovation is like that. Danger. The religion becomes something else, like the Yahud and the Nasara. Small innovation becomes shirkun billah, clear shirk. From the dangers of innovation is that the Nabi al-Mustafa al-Amin al-Aqib al-Mahi Abu al-Qasim sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, "Inna Allah qad hajaba tawbata an kulli sahib bid'atin hatta yad'a bid'atuh." Allah has put a hijab, a veil, over the eyes, the heart, the mind of every innovator until he stops his innovation. This man who says, huwa, 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 Allah, 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 he won't make tawbah from that because he believes what he's doing is correct. Going around the Kaaba, making dua that have no place when you think you have to make this particular dua at this time. Or the things that you're saying. Things that you're saying are not correct. If you say to him, ya hajj, The tawaf al-ifada. You have to cover up your shoulder on this one and there's no running. He'll just spit on you. You don't love Rasulullah. And you just have to take it. The tawaf al-ifada right here, this is not the time for this. That was the tawaf al-qudum when you first came. And the person won't make tawbah. The one who drinks khamr, he makes zina. The one who's getting high, whatever, he's gambling. He knows what I'm doing is wrong. Even if his heart gets blacker and blacker and blacker, he knows I'm doing wrong. The innovator, he doesn't know that. He will fight you for his innovation. Like the man who was caught during the time of the people of the past. And when they were about to kill him, he was proud and happy for what he did. Yeah, you caught me, but I did what I had to do. And plus, I put in your religion so many weak hadith. The Khalifa of the Muslims at that time said, yeah, that's okay. We're still going to take you out. Your life is done right now. And those weak hadith, we have someone to take care of those hadith. Abdullah ibn Mubarak. We have Hamad ibn Salama. So these hadith, we have someone who's going to deal with them. But the point is, the man was like, yeah, go do it. I got mine off. From the dangers of the innovation is that the innovations of Ikhwani, no matter how much you do, it will render your deeds null and void. من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد. Anyone who introduces something in this religion that's not from it, anyone who does something in this religion that is not from it, it will be rejected. It will be rejected. مثل الذين كفروا بربهم. The example of those people who disbelieve in their Lord. This is the case of the kuffar, but the concept is still the same. كَرَّمَادٍ اشْتَدَّتْ بِهِ الرِّيحِ فِي يَوْمٍ عَاصِفٍ. Those people who disbelieve in Allah, they're like the people who, on a day of a turbulent wind and storm, he's like ashes in a hurricane. Ashes in a hurricane. Not a building, ashes in a terrible whirlwind. Those ashes are not going to stay there. They're not going to stay there. الذين كفروا أعمالهم كسراب بقيعة يحسبه الظمآن ماء حتى إذا جاءه لم يجدوا شيئا. Those people who disbelieve in Allah, the kuffar, disbelieve in Allah, they're like, their actions, their deeds are like the mirage. It's just a mirage. It's not real. It's not real. And the innovations are the same way. From them, and we end with these two, is that when people do innovations, they're going to be responsible for what they did, and they'll be responsible for the people who did something behind them in Surah An-Nahl. لِيَحْمِلُوا أَوْزَارَهُمْ كَامِلَةً يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ وَمِنْ أَوْزَارِ الَّذِينَ يُضِلُّونَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. They will be held accountable to carry their mistake, يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ, completely. And some of the mistake of those people they misguided after them. من سن في الإسلام سنة سيئة فعليه وزره وزرها وزر من عمل بها من بعدي. Anyone who he does a bad sunnah, innovation, a bad thing, he will get the reward, the sin of everyone who worked after him by that innovation, by that bad deed, without their deed being depleted one bit. Also, he's cursed, Ikhwani. The innovator is cursed. In Al-Medina, the Prophet told the people, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من أحدث فيها أو آوى محدثا فعليه لعنة الله والملائكة والناس أجمعين. Anyone who innovates in Medina, or he gives sanctuary to an innovator, then the curse of Allah will be upon him, and the curse of the malaik, and the curse of all of the people. He's changing the complexion of the deen of Allah. And there are other problems as well. So the point here, and we end with this point, innovations, they have reached every nook and cranny in the Islamic Muslim identity. With knowledge, we empower ourselves, and we put ourselves in a position to get protected. And from the dua of our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is that he used to ask Allah to forgive him for what he knew and what he didn't know of his mistakes. There are many things we know that we're doing, and there are many things that we don't even know that we're doing. Inculcate that and make it a part of your dua. And never allow yourself to become maghroor. Ya ayyuha salafi. Don't allow yourself to become maghroor. Maghroor is you're so impressed with yourself because you're on the dawah and you're not like your relatives. You know the importance of the sunnah and you're not like other people. Yeah, although you are like that, we don't have a lot of knowledge. So there are many things that we are doing, that we could be doing, where we are compromising the religion. And it is not what is acceptable by Allah Azza wa Jalla. It is an innovation. The way we're judging, the way we're acting, the way we're being. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by his ism and adham to make us far away from innovation and the people of innovators, other than to give them da'wah and to correct them so that we can carry the goodness of them changing their situation. Oh Allah, protect us from innovation. Protect our women, our children from innovation. And bring the Salafis back to their rushd and get us away from this da'wah that has nothing to do with what the pious predecessors were upon. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ونسأل الله تعالى التوفيق والسداد. Brothers asking about an issue that is prevalent in many messages when you put the curtain up that divides the men and the women. What's the ruling of this particular issue? The ruling of it is that it is an innovation in the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal, because again, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had the ability to do that. He could have easily erected, constructed a curtain that separates the men and the women, and he didn't. But he took other steps to ensure that people were segregated to the best of their ability. By telling the people the best role for the men is the first, and the worst role for the men is the last, best role for the women is the last, and the worst role for the women is the first. So the men would start lining up from the front to the back. The women would line up from the back to the front. He used to tell the women to take time coming up from a sajda so that they wouldn't see the aura of any man, if that happened to happen, especially in the beginning when they made hijrah to Al-Madinah and they were poor masakeen. So the scholars use one of the ways that something is halal or haram in Al-Islam. It's not as strong as the Quran in terms of its ability. It's not as strong as the Sunnah in terms of its ability to legislate. It's not as strong as Al-Ijma or Al-Qiyas, but it does have a position. It's called Al-Musalih Al-Mursala. Al-Musalih Al-Mursala. It can make something haram or halal. What is it? It is the process in which there is something that if you do it, is going to bring benefit to the Muslims, the community. And if you don't do it, harm will come to them. It's not in the Quran and the Sunnah to do this thing, but if you do it, it'll bring benefit to the Muslims. And if you don't do it, it can bring some harm to the Muslims. So because of the maqasid of the deen, the goals and the objectives of the deen, from the most important goals and objectives to bring as much good to the people and to push away as much evil, to eradicate it. So it has its basis as a principle. For an example, this thing right here. This thing right here. Is this an innovation? Yes, it's an innovation, but it's not in the deen. The watch is an innovation. Yes, it's an innovation, but it's not in the deen. Using this and using this is going to bring good benefit. People going to hear us far and wide, all the way in that other hall where the swimming pool used to be, and the old masjid over there. They can't see us from here, but they can hear us. So when we're praying salat of a tarawih, they can't see us all the way in that third section, all the way over here. Because they can hear this, they know what we're doing and so forth and so on. It's benefit. Provided that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't have the ability to do it. If he had the ability to do it and he didn't do it, then you don't do it. But if he didn't have the ability to do it, then you don't do it. He didn't have the ability to do this. This technology was, jazakallah khair, was beyond his time in terms of manufacturing it. He prophesied certain things similar to this, but he didn't have the means and the ways at that time in his environment to manufacture this. With the separation, he had the ability. Abu Bakr, give me some of your money. Uthman, Abdurrahman ibn Auf, Abu Talha, Al-Ansari, give me some money. I'm going to erect this thing to separate the men and the women. He didn't do that. So we shouldn't do it because he had the ability. As for the fiqh of the issue, I would advise brothers, don't make a big deal about it though. The way we enjoin the good and forbid the evil, sometimes we're a bit too rough and tough. There are more important things to deal with, more dangerous innovations that people have fallen to, innovations that are disbelief, the bid'ah mukaffara, that put people outside of the fold of Islam. So we have to prioritize these issues. Don't let this be the most important thing in the aspect of your doubt. The more ikhtilaf we know about, what scholars took positions, the better we know how to deal with it. There are certain scholars who said that this innovation was the sunnah. So if you know that a scholar said that and he's a bona fide scholar, Al-Imam Al-Kharqi. Al-Imam Al-Kharqi is a big imam in Islam. He said you should put the rocks in the water. You brothers had laughed when I said that. He said you should put the rocks in the water. Al-Imam Ibn Qudama, You say you should make this particular dua. When you do this, make this dua, make that dua. I don't say the dua is an innovation, but him saying you should make this dua here, no. So the more we know about the khilaf, the ikhtilaf, the better we know how to deal with it. I took this position that you put the rocks in the water. He knows a scholar said that. He's not going to say to me, you're an innovator. Because if I'm an innovator just like that, then what about that scholar? If I did it, I'm ignorant. What about him? That scholar said that that man is Salafi. That scholar said it. He's bigger than you and your sheikh. And he said that. You're an innovator because you're so... What are you talking about? So let us learn the art and the etiquette of al-khilaf. That's a question that actually causes the heart to become cool with sakina. Right, the student picks that up. Barakallah feek wa ahsanallah ilayk. Can someone restrict that? No, shouldn't be restricted. There is a principle in al-Islam, al-ibra bi'umum al-love. Bi'umum al-love. The benefit comes from the generality of what's being said and not to the specific reason why it was said. Not the specific reason why it was said. La'na means that the person is far away from the rahmah of Allah. When you say la'natullah alayhi, that dua is asking Allah to make him far away from his rahmah. Yawm al-Qiyamah, one of the dangers of innovators, innovation, is that you won't drink from the fountain of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, rahmah. And then the Nabi will come to get involved and say to the angels, let them drink, let them drink. They're for my community. They're Muslims. They're for me. The angels will say, you don't know what they innovated after you. You don't know what they innovated. A dalil that the Prophet didn't know everything, that he's not Hazir Nazir. If he was Hazir Nazir, he would have been there and he would have known what they innovated. It's also a dalil that he died. What they did after you died, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When they say that to the Nabi and he heard that these people had the nerve and the audacity to introduce in his religion, after the clarity that has come from the Quran and the Sunnah, and after he has established the hukum and the dalil and the hujjah against them, he who was sent as a rahmah to all of the worlds, because of you, we created the world. But Allah said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ مَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنُّ وَالْإِنسِ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I didn't create the mankind or the jinn except to worship me. Not for you, Ya Muhammad. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةٍ لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We didn't send you except as a rahmah. We only sent you because of rahmah. We didn't create this because of you. We sent you because of this. When the Prophet hears that these people innovated, may Allah save us from this, he will say, suhqan, suhqan. Get them away, get them away. Get them away from me. And this is a person who has the ability for shafa'a yawm al-qiyamah. People who deserve to be in the hellfire, he will get involved and say, no, get them out. Bi-ithnillah. People who deserve to be punished, he will get involved and say, no. All different kinds of abilities to make shafa'a. His uncle died as a kafir. He intercedes on his behalf. He gets the least punishment in the hellfire. So they will be put far away from the rahmah of Allah Azza wa Jal in that particular regard. May Allah Ta'ala help and protect us from being from this category of people. During the khilaf of the Amir al-Mu'mineen al-Faruq radiallahu anhu, there was a severe drought. A man was caught stealing and he stole enough that warranted his hand to be chopped off. Umar radiallahu anhu, before executing the Hajj, he questioned the man, what's the deal? Why did you do that? He said, Amir al-Mu'mineen, you see the situation, there's no food. I didn't have any money. My circumstances were straitened. So I stole it to eat. He let it go. He didn't hold him responsible. Why? He didn't hold him responsible because of the goals and the objectives of the religion. From the goals and the objectives is, if a person is dealing with severe circumstances, he may be pardoned for certain things that he says and he does. Oh Allah, you are my slave and I'm your Lord. Because he was so happy that his animal came back, his tongue got messed up. She was so sad She said to the Nabi, get away from me. You don't know what I'm dealing with. Get out of here. Because she was so sad and distraught. He said, after the rain came down, the rain has come because of this star and that star. It was so happy. Ignorance. He didn't know ignorance. So when people suffer from extremes and they do and they say things in that moment of the extreme forces touching him, pushing him or her, Al-Islam takes that into consideration. Justice. وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ صِدْقًا وَعَدْلًا. The words of your Lord, his words, his religion, his book, the sunnah that comes from Allah, it has been complete in truthfulness and justice. Why are you going to get his hand chopped off? And he was forced to steal his condition, circumstances. So in this case, Umar, he had with him the dalil. He had with him the dalil. Since we have microphones, and the microphone, the voice can be heard from outside, that's the goal and the objective. So why would that be considered to be an innovation? That is the position and the argument of some people of knowledge. That the fact that the voice is going out, the ruling, the illah, the hikmah, the reason why the adhan is being made, it is happening. It's happening. So this doesn't get the rule of being an innovation. That is a ruling that some of the scholars of Al-Islam have given. So we won't say that the mu'adhin is a mubtadi', and we won't say the administration of that masjid a mubtadi'a, and we won't say anyone who prays in that masjid is mubtadi'. These are rules and rulings that are not right. Whoever doesn't make a person an innovator, that I make an innovator, then he's an innovator. And whoever doesn't make the person who doesn't make the person an innovator, who doesn't make the other person an innovator, and on and on and on, to sense. So in this case, some scholars took that position. But other scholars took the other position. And the other position is, it is very easy to get away from the khilaf altogether. It's easy to get out of the ikhtilaf, easy. By simply doing what? Making the adhan from the door, making the adhan from a place other than by the minbar inside of the masjid. Then we have no issue whatsoever. Khurujan min al-khilaf, getting out of the issue is easy. Getting out of the issue. But that is a good point, and it's a good point to end on, and that is the importance of knowledge. As students, let us be careful about saying things are innovations and then passing judgments after that. We have to know, to the best of our ability, as much of the khilaf and the ikhtilaf as possible. Or why else the Al-Imam Al-Bayhaqi write a book called Al-Khilafiyat? Things that the scholars had ikhtilafan in wudu. Do you do the nose and the mouth one time together or separately? Because if you took the other, but you say it's innovation. Nah, it's ikhtilaf. And you shouldn't be in a position to be talking. The more of this issue you know, the more you know how to deal with people. Now, if someone comes and says, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, they were kuffar, are we going to say, oh, that's ikhtilaf. Don't deal with them in a rough way. No, we're not going to say that's ikhtilaf in that. We're going to say, this is something that is known in the deen necessarily, the durura. Everyone knows that. But even still in that case, look at that guy's situation. And his circumstances will determine and dictate even him how you're going to deal with him, right? Why? Because the deen is not for you and me just to practice it the way we want to put our intellect first. Your Lord's words, the words of your Lord, have been completed with sidq and justice. And everybody's case is different. And we give them the rules appropriate to what fits them with sidq and justice. The enemy and the friend, the foe, the friend, Muslim, kafir, man, woman, the one who's on your madhab, not on your madhab, likes your imam, doesn't like your imam, person you like, you don't like him, and so forth and so on. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika wa ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.